weeks, then I won't have to worry anymore. That hasn't been really working out according to plan. Through that pregnancy, through my pregnancy with Gordon, through welcoming these two children into my life, becoming their mother, I found that every day I have grown in my love for them. And along with that growing in love has come a growing in care and concern for their health and well-being. At some point along the line, I don't think it actually took me that long, the penny dropped. And I realized that welcoming this new kind of love into my life was also signing up for a whole new kind of worry. I'm going to ask you to think for a moment about the people that you love most in your life. I want you to think about what makes it easy to love them. Maybe it's intuitive. Maybe they are part of your flesh and blood. Maybe you have a lot in common with them. Maybe you enjoy spending time together. I want you to think now about what makes it hard to love these people who are closest to you. I'm guessing that you probably, like me, know what it is to worry for the people that you love. Maybe you have known what it is to be disappointed by somebody close to you, and maybe you have been disappointing to somebody close to you. Maybe you know what it is to have to overcome differences and compromise. Forgive and try to forget. Maybe you have come face to face with just how brief, how fragile our human lives are. Maybe you know what it is to love and to suffer loss. Here's the thing. It's hard enough to love the people who are easy to love. But Jesus doesn't actually tell us that we're to love our family members and that we're to love the people that we like hanging around with. Jesus tells us that we are to love our neighbor. And then Jesus shows us that we are never off the hook with anyone. The definition of neighbor expands to encompass every single person that we meet. As our baptismal covenant says, I will seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving my neighbor as myself. So if it's hard to love the people who are easy to love, how much harder is this Christian way, this Christian calling, which asks us to love people that we don't get along with, people that we don't understand, people that are nothing like me, people who are too much like me, and I don't like seeing my own shortcomings reflected back to me in their company. People who are all too easy to overlook, to not see, the ones who live on the margins of our society. How is it that we are asked to love them? I want to share with you a brief quote from this book, Soul Making, by Alan Jones. Alan Jones is a priest in the United States. He's also a writer and teacher. He says, what believers tend to do, oh, sorry, as we are in the school above, and there is no real loving without tears. It would be easy for us to be sentimental today. It's Mother's Day, the occasion. We have three beautiful babies who have just been baptized into the church, into the body of Christ. We have six young people who are about to be confirmed in our cathedral in Hamilton. It would be easy to just be warm and sentimental about all of those things. But God gathers us together as a church, not so that we can live nicely and comfortably on the surface of warm and fuzzy feelings, but so that we can go deep. We are asked today to go deep. To go deep into the Christian life, into the life of baptism. Deep into the choice that we make day by day and even moment by moment. To die to an old way of life. The way of life that is endlessly and seductively floated in front of our noses. The way of life that says, I am the center of the universe and this life is just about me. We are asked to go deep into that choice to die to that way of life so that we might be joined once again into Jesus' life, into resurrection life here and now, the life of being a student, of learning and growing in how to both give and receive love. The life, ultimately, of self-offering. We are asked to go deep into those practices that we are given that equip us as students in this way of love. The practices that are foundational in our baptismal covenant, practices of giving and receiving forgiveness, practices of prayer and community, practices of learning to listen to the wisdom of our ancestors passed along down to us. Practices of matching our words and our actions to the things that we say that we believe. Practices of training our eyes to see the value, the inherent dignity of each and every person that we meet. Practices of peace and justice, practices that teach us to treat the world around us as God's masterpiece. We are asked to go deep today. We're asked to be honest about the tears and the challenges of learning how to love. We're also asked to celebrate. We're asked to celebrate that bigger version of what Mother's Day can mean in the Christian tradition. We're asked to celebrate the baptism of Aria and Adeline and Elliot. We're asked to celebrate the upcoming confirmation of Gavin and Aiden, Savannah, Anna, Abby, and Rachel. We're asked to celebrate because, as Alan Jones says, there is no way other than learning to love to become fully human, to have our souls made into the fullness of what God has created us to be. There is no way other than learning to see and care for my neighbor, whoever that may be. There is no way other than that of abiding in God's love and learning to walk with God. Savannah, Anna, Abby, May you be blessed each day with the ability to grow into the fullness of all that God has created you to be. And may you learn to be students in the way of love, so that you might know the one who created you.